shaking, you can see the back of the brain starts to light up.
Tonight on The Fifth Estate. They call it shaken baby syndrome, and for decades, the diagnosis was as good as a conviction.
They brought a doll in and wanted me to demonstrate how I shook her.
Thousands were convicted, families shattered, lives destroyed. But now there are doubts. Does the syndrome even exist?
There has been a terrible mistake, and the consequences of our getting this wrong is just so devastating for so many families.
Tonight, the battle that is rending the medical world, pitting a handful of questioning scientists against a powerful orthodoxy.
We don't want to believe that people will do this kind of thing to children, but I bury the children, and I'm here to tell you that people do it.
And questioning whether some of those convictions might have been wrong.
I lost everything. I lost my family, I lost my daughter, I lost my girlfriend, I lost everything. It's just went right out the window and everything changed.
They were just teenagers when they started dating, still living at home with their parents. 6 months later, Jeff Smith and Natasha Scott discovered they were about to become parents themselves.
How do you plan to have children? Nobody plans to have children. It's just an accident. Like, two teenagers not protected is the accident.
They weren't unhappy, but it was a difficult pregnancy. Natasha struggled to stay in school while Jeff worked to pay for the tiny apartment they'd found in the Toronto suburb of Scarborough. At 4.5 months, they learned Natasha was carrying not one baby, but two. 6 weeks later, the twins arrived, a full 3 months premature.
Katie let out one little cry and then went blue, and they rushed her into a little incubator and cleaned her up a bit and put all these wires on her and needles into her and stuff like that. And it was kind of a scary situation to be in.
How big were they?
A pound and a half. They sat actually in your palm of your hand. Once we got to Sick Kids Hospital, her little head sat there and her feet would come to about here.
The babies were so small, doctors weren't sure they'd survive and warned the parents to prepare for the worst. Jeff quit his job so he could spend more time at the hospital. He hadn't anticipated becoming a father at the age of 17. His mother, Gloria, remembers he was a good one.
Oh, he adored them. He really did. He was such a happy daddy. He really loved them. You could see it in him, you know, when he would hold them and rock them, you know. And proud, he wanted to show them off to everybody.
It would be months before that could happen. Even in the hospital, Katie and her sister Kelly suffered bouts of respiratory distress, what the doctors called apnea. After 13 weeks, it appeared they'd stabilized. And having arranged for regular nurses' visits, Jeff and Natasha finally got the okay to take their babies home.
Oh, it was joy. It was fun. At least we had them, right? And it was finally we get to go home and be a family. It's nice, but the other hand, they were very sick. And one would crash, the other one would crash. One would crash, the other one would crash. And then
to stop breathing.
Yeah. And it was terrible. It was just terrible. And it was taking a toll on all of us.
Each crash sent them running back to the emergency ward. For the new parents, it was terrifying. But after so many visits, Gloria could see the hospital staff was getting frustrated.
I believe because they were so young, sometimes I don't think the hospitals took them seriously enough, which I thought was really wrong, because they've had some incidents where they've gone to the hospital and they've sent them home. They've called them like overzealous parents.
Then came the morning of March 21st. Katie in particular had a rough night. Natasha had to go out, leaving Jeff home alone with the babies for the first time.
I made the bottles come back and I went to pick Katie up. She went very limp on me. Like, she was like our color, skin, breathing, just went limp.
As luck would have it, the health nurse was just arriving for her daily visit. It didn't take her long to realize something was seriously wrong.
It just happened so fast. She turned around and yelled to me, call 911. And then she started a CPR on the child. And then everybody showed up, ambulance, fire, police, everybody. One of the drivers, the ambulance driver, said that she's pretty bad. He really wanted this child to go over and be airlifted or over to Sick Kids Hospital. That's kind of scared me. Because then when he said, no, okay, and I said, well, where are you bringing her? And he said, just to Scarborough General.
For 7 hours, Katie was watched in the Scarborough Hospital. By the time she finally did get transferred to Sick Kids in Toronto, it was too late. Katie was brain dead. The next day, her young parents had to make the painful decision to remove the life support.
It was sad. It hurt. For all the work that we've done and all the effort that I've done to try to save these children and bringing them back and forth, how many times I've gone to the hospital, it hurt. It hurt.
But for Jeff Smith, the loss of his young daughter was only the beginning in what was to become an 18-year horror story. In the days that followed, Katie's sudden death was scrutinized by the experts at Sick Kids. Pathologists found she died of a brain hemorrhage. There was also evidence her brain was swollen and that she was bleeding behind her eyes. In child abuse circles, they call it the triad, and then, as now, it usually points to one conclusion, abuse. Katie, the doctor said, had been shaken to death. As the last person caring for her, Jeff was now a murder suspect. Which immediately raised concerns for the safety of her twin. 3 days after losing Katie, Jeff was summoned back to Sick Kids Hospital and told to bring baby Kelly with him.
When I walked in, there was two officers, there was children's aid and about four doctors, and I knew it wasn't good as soon as I seen everybody else standing there. So I had no choice but to hand the baby over, and it was terrible, just the way they did it.
One daughter dead, the other in protective custody. Within weeks, Jeff was charged with second-degree murder. According to the experts, the scientific evidence was overwhelming. At first, Natasha defended Jeff, but by the time the trial rolled around, she too had become a believer. Because back in the 1990s, everyone was.
Hundreds of babies die every year from a preventable health problem, shaken baby syndrome.
University Hospital is trying to prevent such tragedies with an educational tool.
Remember to never, never shake your baby.
Never, 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 never shake your baby.
As horrible as it was to contemplate, the idea that someone could become so angry, so frustrated, they'd actually shake a child to death had gone mainstream.
Shut up!
It didn't matter that the syndrome was based on a hypothesis. The notion was powerful, and so were the doctors behind it. Pediatricians, mostly, who established a national center in Utah, funding conferences and lobbying efforts, and offering prosecutors and police a well-financed resource center. Against all of that, defendants like Jeff Smith rarely stood a chance. He always denied shaking Katie and believed the courts would clear him. But it didn't happen.
19-year-old Jeffrey Smith seen talking to his lawyers here on Judgment Day, and the verdict, not guilty of second-degree murder, but guilty of manslaughter. The jury.
In 1996, he was sentenced to a year and a half in prison. For Natasha, who ended up testifying against him, it would never be long enough.
I think that he should have got more than 18 months.
Yeah.
18 months wasn't enough for the child's life that he took.
When we come back.
Okay. Here's the baby, John. What do I do?
Okay, so just shake the baby as violently as you can for as long as you can.
The science gets put to the test.
3, 2, 1.
The theory that shaking can kill took off in the 1980s. Today, shaken baby syndrome, or SBS, is so established, even TV doctors are quick with a simple diagnosis.
Yeah, we see it in the ERs, and they come in, and parents, they just lose their cool. And
it can take one shake, and a baby can suffer
serious brain damage. Simulator can show you how that brain damage can happen. Okay, this baby starts to cry, and with a bit of forceful shaking, you can see the back of the brain starts to light up. That indicates a baby was shaken like that will probably have visual problems, because this part of the brain controls vision. And as shaking continues, the front part of the brain lights up, and a baby there would have behavior problems, developmental problems, things like that.
For pediatricians especially, here was an explanation for some of the medical mysteries that until now science seemed unable to explain.
Shaking a baby is a violent action as a result of losing one's temper, which means losing control, losing reason, losing boundaries, and holding a baby and violently shaking them back and forth.
Dr. Robert Block heads the American Academy of Pediatrics and sits on the board of the National Center on Shaken Baby Syndrome.
So what is happening inside that child's body when that shaking, that violent shaking, is going on?
Some of that's a little bit up for further resolution now, because you obviously can't shake a baby, and a real baby, and observe what's going on. But what's happening is that as the head is moving back and forth, it's also rotating, and rotational forces and acceleration, which means speeding up, and deceleration, which means stopping quickly. Those forces act on the brain to change its shape, which injures the nerve cells, injures blood vessels in the brain, injures the brain's ability to function as it normally should.
That's what the SBS believers think. But in laboratories around the world, including this one in Oxford, England, scientists are challenging the pediatrician's beliefs. Wayne Squire has spent 30 years studying children's brains and no longer believes shaking alone can cause the constellation of injuries that make up the syndrome.
I don't think we can be sure there's been shaking unless we have evidence to support it, and that would be, in my opinion, we would need to see damage to the neck, both to the spine or the back of the brain where it joins onto the spinal cord, or to the bones or the soft tissues in the neck, and probably bruises around the body and possibly fractured ribs where a parent had picked up a baby and shaken it hard enough to inflict this kind of injury, because you would have to shake pretty hard.
Have you ever seen that?
I've never seen anything that I'm sure is due to shaking, no.
Which brings us back to Jeff Smith. When he went to trial in 1996, there was no evidence that his baby daughter, Katie, had suffered neck damage, fractures, or bruises. And yet the experts insisted he had shaken her. According to his lawyer, David Bayless, the testimony revolved around the brain hemorrhages she and her twin sister, Kelly, both had.
There were previous bleeds in both of the twins' heads documented in their medical records. Mm-hmm. So the evidence of prior bleeds, from our perspective, was consistent with some sort of a medical condition that was recurring.
Wayne Squire thinks that's entirely possible. Her research tells her that brain hemorrhages have many potential causes, including infections and the trauma that often comes with just being born.
Nearly half of all newborn babies have bleeding around the brain, and I think we are not recognizing the frequency with which an old bleed is still underlying the cause of collapse in these babies. And I think, talking to colleagues, that I would imagine that something like 75 or 80% of shaken baby syndrome involves a chronic subdural hemorrhage, an old bleed that's been lingering around the brain and hasn't gone away.
But what about the evidence of bleeding behind Katie's eyes? Retinal hemorrhaging, along with brain swelling, are the two other pillars of the SBS syndrome. On the stand, the consulting ophthalmologist was categorical.
I mean, his position was that regardless of anything else, even if there were no other injuries, even if there was no bleeding, nothing, the very fact that she had these particular hemorrhages in her eyes meant that she had been shaken.
Where you actually see the hemorrhages is not here, but it's...
Forensic pathologist Pat Lance has been looking to validate the SBS theory for years, but he hasn't been able to. In 2004, he started examining the eyes of every cadaver he autopsied. In 2 years, more than 1,000 pairs of eyes. What he found is that no matter what the cause of death, 1 out of 7 showed evidence of retinal bleeding.
And they may be associated with infections, inflammation of the brain, or in cases of trauma where there's no suspicion of abuse whatsoever. Most forensic pathologists, medical examiners don't examine eyes unless abuse was suspected. If you are only looking for retinal hemorrhages to find abuse, and then you see retinal hemorrhages, and then you call it abuse, it's circular reasoning.
Circular it may be, but for years it was unchallenged in the medical world. Those who tried dismissed as fringe. But like fringes everywhere, they've found a community and host their own anti-SBS conferences, like this one in BC this summer.
We are there to defend what we believe, and it's a rare person that can step outside him or herself and objectively look at the evidence.
Like most medical practitioners, John Plunkett, a forensic pathologist from Minnesota, started out an SBS believer. That's what he was taught. And the syndrome is still taught in virtually every medical school in the world. For Plunkett, that's a big part of the problem.
And I think the natural tendency is, in a student-teacher relationship, to believe what your teacher has told you. And I think that's what's happened here. And you need some pretty powerful incentives to show you that this may have been wrong.
Plunkett's incentives came when he started reading beyond the medical literature and delved into the world of biomechanics. It's where everything we know about safety comes from airbags in cars to bike helmets for kids. According to SBS believers, this is what happens when a baby is shaken. What's called the brain's bridging veins rip apart, causing the hemorrhaging and swelling that are part of the syndrome. But when biomechanical engineer Chris Van E tried to model the kind of force that would be necessary to damage bridging veins, he couldn't do it.
The scenario where you shake and produce these angular accelerations that produce this injury in the brain without producing injury anywhere else, that isn't biomechanically valid. That's been shown by my own work as well as others, that you can't generate the angular accelerations associated with bridging vein rupture.
In Jeff Smith's trial, one of the experts testified that baby Katie died from what must have been massive shaking that would have lasted at least 5 minutes and generated a force equivalent to a child flying through the air at 80 miles an hour and striking a tree. Was that even possible? We decided to see. Biomechanical engineer John Lloyd hooked us up with the equipment and the crash test dummy.
Okay, here's the baby, John. What do I do?
Okay, so just shake the baby as violently as you can for as long as you can. Ready?
If I was really angry, right?
Start. 3, 2, 1, begin.
Oh my goodness.
Harder than that. Keep going.
How many seconds is that?
About 8 seconds. 10 seconds.
I can't do it more than that. That's too heavy.
And wow. That's what research shows.
Wow. So show me what we did here then.
This is the data after we've calculated the accelerations, the angular accelerations. And the maximum value I'm seeing is about 1,200 radians per second squared in terms of angular acceleration. Let me give that to you in meaningful terms. It's about 12% of the actual angular acceleration that would be required to cause a brain injury in an infant.
12%?
Only 12%.
I didn't even come anywhere.
Didn't come close.
But does that mean no one can do it? We went back to the lab.
I'm not the biggest and strongest person in the world, but is it possible that somebody stronger than me can generate more force?
It's possible. Mm-hmm. Let me give it a try.
You gonna try? Okay.
Hey, ready?
Mm-hmm.
In the biomechanical experiments, even the biggest college football players couldn't shake hard enough to do damage. John Lloyd is a former rugby player.
And that's about it.
Let's see, what did you do here?
All right, so this is the analyzed data from my event of shaking the infant mannequin. And I was able to generate only a hair more angular acceleration than you were, maybe about 1,250 radians per second squared. So we're in the same ballpark.
Chris Vanney was not surprised.
The anatomy is different in both structure and composition.
It is possible, in theory, he says, to shake a child to death, but...
If you have a child with a brain injury with no other sign of impact or abuse on them whatsoever, with a subdural hematoma, I just don't think that shaking was the thing that produced rotational accelerations to rip a bridging vein. That just doesn't seem to follow.
Now, that kind of biomechanical work was still in its infancy when Jeff Smith went to trial. His lawyer tried to introduce evidence that questioned the SBS hypothesis, but he was outgunned. He had two expert witnesses. The Crown had nine, some of whom made it quite clear that, science aside, Jeff was just the kind of parent to lose it.
The evidence was to the effect that basically certain types of people shake babies. And the types of people who shake babies are parents who are inexperienced, parents who might have stresses in their lives, such as poverty, parents who might have stresses in their lives, such as sick babies. So ironically, the stress that that Natasha and Jeff had with their children, which was largely trying to keep them healthy, constantly taking them to the hospital because they thought they'd stop breathing from these apnea attacks, those stresses became evidence that one of them had shaken the baby. It was very Kafkaesque.
When we come back, the SBS juggernaut rolls on.
They were hollering and hollering, and I couldn't take it anymore. I started to vomit. My body started to seize, and they had to call an ambulance for me.
And the victims aren't just parents.
You've been told that you shouldn't talk about this for the time being.
Yes.
And you take that seriously?
I do, yes. Yes, my whole profession, my ability to work, hangs in the balance.
There are no reliable statistics in this country for how many babies get diagnosed with SBS or how many parents and caregivers get charged. In the United States, they estimate as many as 200 people a year are convicted. But for parents, it doesn't take a jail sentence to do life-altering damage. Zabeth and Paul Baines of Surrey, BC, had never heard of SBS until September 2007, when their son, a toddler, tripped over his baby sister, banging her head into the floor.
I can't surmise how fast he was falling on her or anything. I just know, how much he weighed and where he was coming and how he was running.
Were you concerned after you'd seen this happen?
Oh, heavens, yes. Oh, heavens, yes. But I was surprised, too, that she was only whimpering.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, I thought that after that she would have been screaming.
They went to the emergency ward anyway, and after 2 weeks of getting no answers at local hospitals, ended up at the Children's Hospital in Vancouver. By that time, the baby's symptoms, a brain bleed and retinal hemorrhage, were clear. Soon, too, was a pediatrician's diagnosis.
She has shaken baby syndrome.
Yeah, she's been shaken.
And
she's been shaken.
I felt like I didn't know. I hadn't heard of
you
this.
You sat there
in
shock.
We're parents of two other children, but I actually haven't heard of shaken baby syndrome before. But it wasn't good.
Well, so she comes in and says, I've concluded that this baby was shaken.
Yeah.
And you said, presumably, well, hang on just a second, there was this impact, this incident that happened a few weeks ago. And what did she say to that?
Shook her head.
She'd hung her head a lot and just shook her head.
Yeah. There's no talking to her at all.
No talking and no stopping what happened next. protocol demanded Child Protective Services be called. The Baines children were taken into custody. As for Paul and Zabeth, they were now suspected child abusers. The police interrogation was brutal.
They brought a doll in and wanted me to demonstrate how I shook her, which obviously I couldn't do. I didn't shake her. And they were hollering and hollering, and I couldn't take it anymore. I started to vomit. My body started to seize, and they had to call an ambulance for me.
And then trying to pit us against each other, they said, oh, you know, your wife told us that you did it. She admitted to it, and then said the same thing to her. And I'm like, no, she didn't.
Nope.
I know better than that.
The police eventually closed the criminal case for lack of evidence, and soon their baby daughter was well enough to go home. But the Baines were never allowed to take her. The children remained in protective custody and were eventually placed in foster homes.
Your heart's been ripped out.
You just die.
Yeah.
It's your living. You have to breathe and eat and get up in the morning, but you don't sleep, you don't eat, you just cry.
There is no overstating the impact of the words child abuser, especially in a prison. In 1996, having been convicted of shaking his daughter to death, Jeff Smith started an 18-month sentence.
I lost everything. I lost my family, I lost my daughter, I lost my girlfriend, I lost everything. My self-esteem, like everything, it's just gone. They took it away. My childhood and everything is just went right out the window, and everything changed.
Among the many things 19-year-old Jeff had to learn was how to survive inside as a baby killer.
I've gotten hit, I've gotten to the hospital, and I've been pushed off ranges, and I guess it could have been worse. They could have killed me in there. They definitely wanted me off the range.
You know, I can't help but feel responsible. I did the best I could during the trial. But I often say to myself, maybe if I'd done something differently, the result might have been different.
There were appeals, but they went nowhere. Still, lawyer David Bayless stayed in touch with Jeff, always believing he'd been wrongly convicted.
So it's the kind of thing you think about constantly. And I would certainly like to see the day when that's corrected.
Among the things that convinces Bayless is the fact that Katie's twin sister, Kelly, suffered the same kind of brain bleeds and continued to suffer them, even after she was taken away from her parents.
I think that was a significant factor in our shock at the verdict. I mean, we thought it was pretty powerful to say, look, the Crown is saying that this has to come from shaking, and yet you know that the surviving twin continued to have subdural bleeding after she was removed from the family. But, you know, it was all part of the culture of that time. I mean, there was a parade of witnesses saying that Katie had been shaken.
A parade of witnesses that Bayless couldn't counteract. Back in 1996, scientists were starting to question SBS, but few were prepared to testify.
I probably spoke to 50 or 60 people all over North America, many of whom expressed very serious reservations about the diagnosis that was being made with respect to Katie's death, but very few of them. In fact, I was only able to convince two of them to come to court and say that because they felt that there was more or less a blackballing that might happen if they were to take a stance against this sort of prevailing culture.
15 years later, that hasn't changed. Wayne Squire is one of Britain's preeminent pediatric pathologists, but her position on SBS has made her a target. Last summer, a well-known SBS believer filed what she claims are bogus professional charges against her that could cost her her medical license. Lawyers have warned her about speaking out, even about doing this interview.
Do you think it's accidental or coincidental that these kinds of charges are being made against you?
No, I don't think so. I think that this has been a coordinated campaign, but I think at the moment it's probably best that we don't go into any detail about my feelings about that.
You've been told that you shouldn't talk about this for the time being.
Yes.
And you take that seriously?
I do, yes. Yes, my whole profession, my ability to work, hangs in the balance.
But Dr. Robert Block has little sympathy. He just doesn't believe what Squire and the others are trying to show. The only real science, he says, is what pediatricians and child abuse experts have been relying on all along.
We would tell you that there are hundreds and hundreds of people who agree to that science. So if you have, make up a number, 300-400 people who agree to the science and one person who doesn't, does that really mean that there's a controversy? Does that really mean that there's new science? It's not my job to prove that they're wrong, because I already don't believe that they're correct. They have to prove to me and the rest of the world that what they're saying is true.
You know, this could be easily, you know, a very interesting academic debate if it weren't for the fact that this affects people's lives. Over the last number of decades, and even today, people are going to jail. They are being convicted because their child has been diagnosed with shaken baby syndrome, and often that is a diagnosis of murder. Do you ever ask yourself, do you ever question whether or not mistakes have been made?
I have yet to find a reporter, including you, who comes to me and says, Dr. Block, what about the babies who are killed? What about the babies who are neurologically impaired forever? Why do they not count? Why is the only person we're concerned about the person who might have been innocent who went to jail?
Back in BC, the Baines escaped jail, but still lost their family, including a new baby born last year. Even before Zabeth was out of the delivery room, child protection workers arrived to take him away, too.
So you lost another baby?
Yeah. And that was even harder, just because he was newborn.
He felt so helpless. Totally helpless.
Yeah.
This whole thing, we felt helpless. Every right has been taken away for a mommy and a daddy. Your right to protect your children from the bad stuff in the world, your right to provide for them, your right to care for them. It's all stripped away.
The Baines launched a court case against the BC government to get their family back. But in the meantime, their children remained in foster care. And Paul, who used to work in sales, and Zabeth, who taught piano, had big changes to make.
What did you do?
Became janitors. Work at night. Clean toilets and wash windows at night so we could be free for our children in the daytime when they have visits and stuff. So we adapted.
Quite a change.
Yeah. We adapted.
Not what you thought life was going to be.
No.
No.
When we come back, the tide begins to change and convictions get re-examined.
To me, this is clearly an infant who died as a result of natural causes. The bottom line, natural causes.
Sixteen years after he was convicted of shaking his infant daughter to death, Jeff Smith still lives with the consequences. He works, but only sporadically, and only in jobs that don't require a criminal record search. No one wants to hire a baby killer. But last year, something happened to give him hope. In light of evolving science, the Ontario government struck a panel of experts to review SBS convictions. Four cases were recommended for judicial review. One of them was Jeff's.
What did you think when you heard that?
I was so relieved. I was so happy. It was just, I don't know what to say, speechless. At least somebody, it's being heard and being talked of, right? I always knew that I never did nothing to these children.
Today, Jeff has big guns in his corner. James Lockyer and his association in the defense of the wrongly convicted have a long history of success.
My experience, I've now been probably through more than a dozen of these. My experience is that in each and every case, you have a natural cause of death beckoning you. And yet that natural cause of death is overrided or overrode by flawed pathology. And I've no doubt this is one of those cases.
and then the Court of Appeal process.
In preparing Jeff's case, Lockyer sought out SBS skeptics to review the testimony. Among the things they discovered was that the bleeding identified in Katie's brain wasn't even associated with the syndrome. Forensic pathologist John Plunkett.
To me, this is clearly an infant who died as a result of natural causes. The bottom line, natural causes. She had no evidence for any external injuries whatsoever, and she had bleeding within the ventricles themselves. That type of bleeding is due almost exclusively to lack of oxygen. It's the type of bleeding that is associated with prematurity.
But not even a judicial review has diminished the certainty of the believers.
Because human nature is what it is, I suspect, we don't want to believe that people will do this kind of thing to children. So we're always looking for reasons to prove that they didn't do it. But I bury the children, and I'm here to tell you that people do it.
They also, he points out, sometimes confess to doing it.
Here's the baby with subdural hemorrhages, maybe a rib fracture, maybe not, retinal hemorrhages in a certain pattern, brain injury that we can see, and they tell us, here's what I did. Now, how in the world can you just forget about all of that because somebody has an alternative hypothesis? That doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah, so I've seen some of those confessions. I've been directly involved in two cases where people pleaded guilty. I mean, that's the ultimate confession.
And in both of those cases, the convictions were overturned.
In the shaken baby cases, they're the cases where you find that the police will exert the most pressure on the individual. They will cajole them, they will persuade them, they will tell them that they know they didn't really mean to hurt the baby, and they will spend hours and hours battering them because the police are so horrified at the crime that they believe has taken place.
You've called this a scandal. How big a scandal is it? What are we talking about here?
Well, we're talking about really an international scandal. This is not exclusive to Canada by any stretch of the imagination. I suspect that we've probably been more careful with it than many countries. Certainly now the courts are beginning to look at it more quizzically, but not nearly quizzically enough in my view.
It took 4 years, but eventually the courts in BC found Zabeth and Paul Baines had not shaken their baby either. They were cleared of abuse allegations, and their children finally returned home. But that doesn't mean the anxiety is over.
Well, we can never work around children again. I can never be a coach of a soccer team or something, because they'll do a background check on me and they'll find out that I have a history, quote unquote.
Even though you were never charged, mm-hmm. You were absolved of what
Just in case. Just in case.
As for the children, they fear the scars will never heal.
They need a lot of reassurance that, you know, they're going to be home forever.
Or accidents that, happening.
Yeah, the children have a fear of accidents. They play too hard, you know. If they get a bruise, even in gym or something, they'll show you and they'll be like, is someone going to take us again? I got a bruise.
It's those kinds of desperate stories that flood Wainey Squire's inbox, even in England, and despite the warnings, keep her speaking out.
There has been a terrible mistake, and the consequences of our getting this wrong is just so devastating for so many families that I feel that I have to do my best to try and get the science out there and to get people to understand that there is another explanation.
As for Jeff Smith, exoneration, if it comes, will be sweet, but not curative. He's lost too much for that. A decade and a half ago, he and Natasha had been starting to build a family, a home, a future. To this day, they do not speak.
That's one of the problems with a wrongful conviction. The stigma always stays there. And Natasha may well never be convinced, and she might well have people telling her, even after Jeff is exonerated, that he's not really innocent.
I'll always remember what she's done to me, but I forgive her. She had to get her daughter back. At least she went to home to mommy. So I can't always hold a grudge and hate everybody. It's, I got enough doctors to hate. So it's, there's enough sadness in my life already. I don't need it.
All these years later, he still makes regular visits to Katie's grave. But the emotions are always double. Her twin sister, Kelly, just turned 18. And yet, since that day she was taken from him in the hospital, Jeff has never been allowed to see her.
You hope that at some point, when she's an adult, that you are able to establish some kind of a relationship with her?
I would love to. Yeah, it would be great.
What would you tell her about all of this, if you could?
I love her. I miss her. And hopefully she comes and visits with me. Maybe even stays with me. It'd be lovely.
We did ask Natasha and Jeff's daughter, Kelly, to participate in our documentary. They chose not to comment. Please stay with us. The Fifth Estate returns.
Just taking me back, when did the whole shaken baby controversy come across your radar screen?
I don't remember the exact date, but Audrey Edmonds was convicted in 1998, and her case was quite controversial, mm-hmm. even at the time she was prosecuted. I didn't really pay a lot of attention to it, though, for a number of years after that. It was sometime then in the early to mid-2000s, probably, that we were notified of the case and started looking into it.
So give me a thumbnail sketch, then, of the Audrey Edmonds case.
Sure. Audrey was, you know, she was your classic middle American woman, married, living in a suburb of Madison, much loved by her community. She had ran an in-home daycare service where she was really a role model for other daycare providers, known to be remarkably patient and sweet. And she had a child. One of the children was dropped off at her home one morning. Hadn't been there in a few days, and the child was unusually fussy that morning. Mm-hmm. Hadn't taken her full bottle as usual and whatnot, and within less than an hour, the child became comatose, essentially, in her home, and Audrey called 911, thinking the child had choked on a bottle of formula. The first responders came, thought it was a choking incident, took her to the hospital, but they quickly found that the child had the classic triad. The retinal hemorrhages, the subdural and subarachnoid hemorrhages, and the brain swelling, and they said, "Well, this must be shaking," and from there went downhill for Audrey. She was convicted, and sent to prison, and she served 11 years in prison before we were finally able to reverse the conviction and get the charges dropped.
And how were you able to do that?
Well, it was interesting. The reason we got interested in this case in the first place is because, well, not only because she was an unusual case of wrongful conviction in that she had really excellent trial lawyers and a really excellent appellate lawyer, and they were both very concerned that she was absolutely innocent mm-hmm. and approached us about that. But we really started getting interested in the case then when we realized that the pathologist, the medical examiner who had done the autopsy on the child in this case and who had testified against Audrey had publicly declared that he had misgivings about, not this case per se, but about some of the things he had previously believed, including that he had previously believed that there could not be much of a what's known as a lucid interval. That is, once a child is injured, they become unresponsive, comatose, essentially quite quickly thereafter, and therefore the person who's with the child at the time is most likely the attacker, or the one who inflicted the injuries. This doctor subsequently had an experience with a child who was admitted to a hospital and was under trained medical personnel supervision for about, oh, I forget what it was, 16 to 18 hours before the child became comatose, before the child went into distress. And trained medical personnel hadn't been able to detect the brewing brain injury during all of those hours. And so mm-hmm. this doctor went back and started doing the research and realized, you know what, there's actually good research showing that a lucid interval is real. And so he wrote a letter to the journal of the whatever it's called, the medical examiner's journal, saying that, describing this experience he's had and saying, you know, lucid intervals are real. We need to re-examine what we've been saying about this. So we called him up and said, you know, how does this apply to Audrey Edmonds? And his response was, oh my goodness, Audrey Edmonds, what are we going to do about her? And so we went from there.
And so just finish the story then. So what happened?
Well, we then assembled a team of experts to look at the case. And really what happened was that Audrey was convicted of a first-degree reckless homicide, which requires proof that she caused injuries to the child and did so with reckless disregard for human life. She caused injuries that caused death and did so with recklessly and with utter disregard for human life. So to prove all of those elements, the state relied exclusively on the medical testimony. Medical testimony showing that the child went into distress in her care, therefore she had to be the one that did it. She's the one who caused it. And they offered testimony suggesting that this had to have been caused by shaking, and that the shaking had to be so severe, they testified, so severe that it would have been the equivalent of throwing a child out of a third-story window or driving into the car a child at 30 miles an hour. And therefore, it had to not only be reckless, but also had to have been done with such utter disregard for human life that it was a first degree offense. So that was the testimony. We went then and we started looking into it, and what we found from these other experts was, actually, you can't diagnose shaking based solely on those medical signs and symptoms, that there are lots of alternative causes that could account for it, that there can be a lucid interval, so even if something was done to this child, you can't time it to Audrey Edmonds necessarily. And we found out that, in fact, this whole theory that the amount of force is the equivalent of throwing a child out of a second or third story window and whatnot has no basis in science whatsoever. In fact, the state's experts admitted that it was merely sort of anecdotal, the kinds of thing they were referring to, and that, in fact, subsequent research had established that children can sustain these kinds of life-ending injuries from falls off of small pieces of furniture or playground equipment. Mm-hmm. So basically, the new science undermined or seriously questioned all of the elements that had previously been established by unquestioned medical testimony.
Why do you think that belief in the triad came to be and came to be so firmly held?
It's hard for me to know, but what I can surmise from talking with the medical experts in the field is that this was a theory. It was proposed as a theory, and it was one that made sense. It made sense to doctors, and they had no other theory to replace it. So it quickly became taught in medical schools, and it became sort of accepted dogma. That's what everybody emerged from medical school, having been trained and having been given no reason to doubt it. They just accepted it. And of course, you can't shake children to test the theory. So it's really hard to prove or disprove it directly through those kinds of testing. And so people just sort of accepted it, never questioned it. And so when you come along and say, wait a minute, that may not be right, it runs counter to everything they've been trained about this with unquestioning authority previously. Mm-hmm. So it's just very hard to replace sort of an old dogma with new truths.
Yeah. It is being questioned now, though. And
it is being questioned quite widely.
So what does that mean in your world, the fact that the science is now starting to question some of the dogma?
Well, from our perspective as lawyers representing people convicted of crimes, it's an interesting case study in sort of that intersection between law and science, where science is always contingent, it's always changing, it's always developing as more research is done, whereas the law demands finality. We want an answer now and we want it to be done with. That's a real problematic scenario when you're basing prosecutions entirely on scientific theory. You're demanding the finality of a criminal conviction in a case where it's based entirely on scientific theory that is shifting and growing and changing and being replaced all the time. And so what that means for us is that it's very likely that there are a lot of people in prison under these final sentences and convictions who may not have committed the crime. Almost certainly many of them did not commit the crimes. And so we need to find a way to reopen these cases, to admit the new evidence, so that, that fact finders can consider the new evidence now and say, wait a minute, we can't be so sure that this person committed this crime. Or in some instances, even we can come in and say, you know what, we actually know what happened, and it wasn't shaking. It was some natural cause. It was some disease or whatever it may be.
Mm-hmm. How important is the emerging science to what's happening in the courtroom?
Well, I mean, because these prosecutions were all science-based. I mean, it's what Professor Deborah Turkheimer has referred to as a medical diagnosis of murder, and that's a pretty apt way of looking at it. There's no other evidence of murder except you got a dead child and the doctors come in and say it had to be murder. Because these prosecutions were built solely on the science, when you come in with new science then that says, wait a minute, we might have had it wrong, that of course should be what it takes to re-examine those cases in the legal world as well. And that's what's starting to happen in a lot of cases now, is that people are going back in and re-examining the basis for these convictions and presenting new medical evidence to show either that there's an alternate cause that can be established now, or at the very least, that the foundations for the medical testimony in the past are seriously questioned now, so that you can no longer be comfortable concluding that the person is guilty beyond a reasonable doubt.
From a legal perspective, what is the most compelling new science that's emerging?
It depends on the case. It really depends on the case. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, it can be everything from the science that suggests, the biomechanical research and other science that suggests, you simply cannot cause these kinds of injuries by shaking a child alone, at least not without severe neck injuries, which you usually don't see in these cases. Mm-hmm. That can be it, or it can be new science about rebleeds, where you've got a case where the child had a chronic subdural hematoma. You can have evidence of a rebleed can provide an explanation for it. I think the new evidence on lucid intervals is extremely important, mm-hmm. because it's that timing element that has permitted prosecutors to convict people by saying it had to be that person and no one else, because we know the child would have been immediately comatose. You really can't say that now. And so that's a very important legal distinction. Even if somebody did something to this child, you can't say that it was necessarily that person. And then there's so many important pieces of the, mm-hmm. of the puzzle, mm-hmm. scientifically. And the other piece that's really, really important, I think, is the fact that we now know that impact can cause so much more force on the brain than any amount of shaking. Mm-hmm. That we now know as well that even minor falls, accidental falls, can cause this. So they used to testify widely, and the prosecutors would admit this. They used to testify widely that short falls can't kill. Well, they don't say that anymore, because they now know short falls can kill. And so you can't just look at a case where you've got a dead child with brain injuries and say, oh, it must be shaking. It can't be an accident. It has to be intentional. Well, no, you can't say that.
This is based on Dr. Plunkett's research.
This is based to a large extent on Dr. Plunkett's research, indeed.
Now, the criticism the other side would make of Dr. Plunkett's research is, well, look, he looked at 18 children of all ages. Only two or three of them were babies. You can't draw any conclusions from that kind of a sampling.
There were children of all ages. Some of them were infants, though. And if the point that the prosecution's witnesses are testifying to is that short falls can't kill, if you find cases where short falls did kill, you have disproved that theory. And that's what Dr. Plunkett's work did. And it doesn't stand alone. Dr. Pat Lance in North Carolina is now doing a lot of work looking at children who died, and people of all ages, including a lot of infants, who died from all kinds of causes unrelated to shaken baby syndrome, and finding the same kind of eye injuries and right. brain swelling and whatnot in a lot of these children. So it's not just Dr. Plunkett's work that stands alone, but I think to dismiss Dr. Plunkett's work on that basis misses the point, which is, all you got to do is find one to disprove a theory, and then it's disproved.
In light of all this, then, in your opinion, is there any validity left to the syndrome, to the shaken baby syndrome?
I'm not a scientist. I can't answer that question. My own personal view is that I'm very skeptical of the science of shaken baby theory because of the biomechanical research that suggests it can't be accomplished, because of the fact that despite the ubiquity of video cameras in our society today, I've never seen an example of a shaking death caught on film. Mm-hmm. We have examples of accidental falls off playground equipment that have resulted in death. There's just so much that, and there's so many other explanations for it that have been overlooked, that it looks very suspect to me. But I can't make that judgment. What I can say is that you can't identify shaken baby syndrome as the cause of most if any of these injuries, given the state of the medical science today. It's just not there. There is interesting research ongoing and new studies coming out today that give us greater insights, but. I've not seen the science yet that proves it, and I think even most of the ardent supporters of shaken baby theory, when pushed, would admit it's a theory.
The new science, if it's as compelling as you and they say, why are there still prosecutions going ahead at all?
Well, there are very good, well-intentioned scientists who still believe in shaken baby theory and are working really hard to try to prove it, and who make great witnesses, and you know. When you've got a dead baby, that's a really compelling case for the prosecution. People want answers. They want to know what caused this child and who can be blamed for it. And when the estate comes in with a string of experts who say it has to be shaking, and the defense comes in, no, it can't be. We think it's this, or we think the impulse is there, I think, to say, well, why would they lie about that? Why, you know, how can they be wrong? Not to understand the science even, but to say these are well-meaning doctors who say it has to be that. Who am I to second-guess that?
Yeah.
It's a really tough thing to ask a jury to decide. I mean, the scientific community itself, the medical community itself, cannot come to an agreement as to whether shaken baby syndrome is causing these deaths. How do we expect a group of lay jurors to figure that out and to figure it out beyond a reasonable doubt? It's really pushing the criminal justice system beyond its capacity to resolve these kinds of things.
Yeah. You are involved with the International Innocence Project, so
right.
I'm guessing by virtue of that you may have some international view of what's happening. How would you describe the state of play now in terms of shaken baby syndrome and what's happening with the courts?
It's in tremendous flux right now.
Yeah.
There's a lot of turmoil going on about this because there has been now a real awakening in some segments of the legal community about the problem here. And so there have been growing efforts to try to stop the stem of unfounded prosecutions and to undo wrongful convictions. That in turn leads to pushback from prosecutors who try to marginalize the experts who testify for the defense, try to marginalize the projects that represent the defendants. And courts are sort of left somewhere in the middle trying to figure out what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think they've figured it out yet. We're sort of in that middle land where we're trying to still wade our way through this. I will say that I think the United States lags behind Canada and the United Kingdom in addressing this, at least in Canada with the gouge inquiry and the United mm-hmm. Kingdom with some serious inquiries by the Attorney General's office there. There have been serious attempts to get to the bottom of this to some degree. There's
mm-hmm.
not been much of that in the United States at all. We're hoping to get there. We have called, for example, for the National Academy of Sciences to do an investigation into shaken baby prosecutions, bringing in scientific experts from a wide array of fields,
mm-hmm.
but who don't have a dog in this fight, who aren't invested in one side or the other, who can evaluate the merits of the arguments on both sides and tell us, well, at least where's the common ground, what is it we can say, what is it we can't say.
Mm-hmm.
So we're hopeful that that kind of thing can come in and help the courts figure out what to do with this, because It's really pushing the capacity of the courts to resolve these kinds of issues.
Where do you think it's going to go? I mean, just given the sort of the tenor of the debate to this point, and are you hopeful this is going to be resolved in some way, or is there a big fight still to come?
I think there's still a big fight to come, but I'm hopeful that in the end, the research will improve and help us come to some resolution, and eventually people will stop talking past one another and start figuring out what they really can agree on and what the science can support and what it can't. And the courts will come to some conclusion about what it takes to convict someone of abuse, where there's nothing but medical evidence. So, you know, I hope we get there someday. We're not there yet.